Hello everyone and welcome to the Trenchless Technology webinar series. My name is Sharon Bueno, Managing Editor of Trenchless Technology, and it's my pleasure to introduce our presentation, Advancements in Slurry Microtunneling for Long Distance and Curved Tunnels, presented by Akkerman. Microtunneling equipment has been around since the 1970s, but within the last decade, technological advancements have expanded the equipment's realm of capabilities for a broader range of ground conditions and longer distances. Improvements in the variety and quality of cutter head tooling, tunneling navigation systems for extended length and curved alignments, lubrication products, and lubrication delivery systems have made it possible to go further at larger diameters. This webinar will overview the slurry microtunneling method, newest equipment innovations, tunneling navigation systems, lubrication options, and recent case studies. Following the presentation, there will be a question and answer session. We encourage you to participate by typing your question into the designated panel in the left-hand portion of your screen. You can also maximize your viewing window by clicking the box with the X at the upper right of the slides. We're going to take a quick poll first, so please submit your answer and then click the blue Return to Presentation button. I'd like to remind everybody that any views or opinions presented in this webinar are solely those of the presenters and do not necessarily represent those of Benjamin Media Incorporated, nor does Benjamin Media endorse any products or methods presented. Speaking today is Troy Stokes. Troy is sales engineer with Akkerman, a leading pipe jacking and tunneling equipment manufacturer. Stokes is responsible for domestic sales along the East Coast in dealership relations and support in Australia and New Zealand. His vocation in the underground construction industry has spanned nearly four decades and has granted him expedition to more than 20 countries. Prior to Akkerman, he was responsible for global equipment sales and service for Soltau Worth Microtunneling for nearly two decades. And now I will turn the presentation over to Troy.
Thank you very much. Welcome, everyone. Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, depending on where you're at. I appreciate you spending the time with us here today. As mentioned, we're going to chat a little bit today about advancements in slurry microtunneling. We're going to go through a little bit of basically a little bit of history, how we got to where we are, what we're doing now that's really cool and really awesome, and then kind of where things are headed, headed in the future. So that's where we're headed, so what do you say we get off on this journey? I guess before we do that, I'll tell you a little bit more about me. Like as mentioned, I've been doing this a long time. For those of you who can see that picture up there, I used to have brown hair when I started doing this, so I've got a few stories to tell. So that's what I've done. I've spent basically my entire adult career, or adult life, I should say, and my professional career working underground. Started in open cut utility work and then migrated over into trenchless work in the late 80s, and that's gotten me to where we are today. So with that being said, let's jump right into this thing. A little bit about Akkerman. I got to give them their due because they do pay my bills, so I got to thank them for that. The company has been around since 1973, which is pretty awesome. For those of you that are being quick, doing a little math, this year is number 45, so we're celebrating our 45th year in business later this year, which is a pretty awesome thing to say. Good family-owned company, third generation of the family is right there, you know, going to be taking the helm here, you know, one of these days. So it's all good stuff. Akkerman is worldwide. We have representation all over the world. You know, just, you know, I guess every continent is represented. And we, you know, do quite a bit of work. Our primary focus is North and Central America, just because of our location. But we are a worldwide company. As a manufacturer, we manufacture four distinct product lines. Everything we do is trenchless, so we're 100% trenchless company. But within that, we have our four distinct product lines: our guided boring lines, microtunneling, which we're going to chat about today. Pipe jacking, tunneling, TBM type stuff, and earth pressure balance or EPB machines. That's our four product lines that we manufacture here in the U.S. And we've been doing our slurry microtunnel system since 1995. So we think we're getting pretty good at that. So let's jump on ahead here. A little bit more about the four product lines. As you can see there, as I mentioned prior, the guided boring. That's going to be another webinar one of these days real soon, because that's a pretty awesome part of the trenchless, the whole trenchless industry. It's very fast growing, extremely fast developing. For us, that concentrates in that 4-inch to 48-inch realm. Slurry microtunneling that we're going to talk today, that's picking up right there at basically 24 ID, or say 30-inch OD product, right up to 114-inch OD. The TBM line is in that 48-inch to 168 or 14-foot TBMs and excavator shields, and then our earth pressure balance machines are in that 102-inch and above. So that's kind of an overview of our four product lines. All right, a little bit about what we're going to do today. Here's a little agenda, so if you see anything in there, you can kind of pick out, and you got to pay close attention, make sure you get a nap in between, and pay attention during all the really good spots. We're kind of going to do the overview, which you're right smack in the middle of right now. We're going to talk about the equipment, again, a little bit of history, how we got here, what's kind of cool, what's new, and what's been developing over the last, say, 10 years or so, and then more recently. Then we're going to speak directly about tunnel navigation, which is, in my opinion, that's the fastest developing area of slurry microtunneling, and basically trenchless technology as a whole is navigation. And then we're going to move that on into microtunnel lubrication. In particular, we're going to talk about lubrication systems and how the development of those systems is really playing a big role in what we're able to do with tunnels today. And then just a few other innovations that just kind of don't really fit into those categories, but that work right along with it. And then at the end, we'll give you a few little case studies to show you that it's not all talk, that we actually do put our money where our mouth is every now and again. All right, right into the overview. Like I say, as far as we mentioned a few moments ago, we're in that size range of, say, a DN24, or DN600, I should say, 30-inch to 114-inch OD. That is not a hard limit. Obviously, we can go smaller and you can go bigger, but that's the core of where this industry works. There's other machines that do better at smaller diameters, and there's other machines out there that can do better at larger diameters. So slurry microtunneling seems to hang out right in that 30-inch to 114-inch range. As you can see, the main goal of that is non-disruptive pipe installation. That's a real fancy word for trenchless, okay? Say no to a backhoe, as my buddy Leo used to say. So you use that underneath your utilities, your highways, airport runways, water, rivers, that sort of stuff. So anything that you want to go under and not disturb, this is your guy right here. The remote control part of things, that's going to fall right into the definition of microtunneling. For those, if you get into, because there is a specific definition for this, and in ASCE standard 3615, I mean, it lays it out very clearly. There's four requirements to be able to call something a microtunnel system, and that the system has to be remote controlled, which means, no personnel in the tunnel for routine operation, obviously maintenance and that stuff notwithstanding. The tunnel must be guided. That's usually a laser, but as advancements are coming along now, we're finding that, laser is not your only guy anymore. So we're going to talk quite a bit about that a little bit later on here. But again, laser is most common. But you're getting in now to our surveyed systems, our azimuth theodolite-based systems that we're going to talk about today. Your gyros are in there, that sort of stuff. That's an active guidance system. Pipe jacking, it's microtunneling is defined as a pipe jacking system. And I wanted to point that out is, not to confuse this with a slurry TBM, because, we've all picked up the magazine or looked at the shows on TV where you've got that big 9-meter diameter machine working through the ground, and it's got a slurry type front end on it, for that particular soil. I mean, that is not a microtunneling machine. Yes, it's a slurry based machine with how it handles the material, but it's not a microtunneling machine because it's not remote controlled and it's not pipe jack. Those are primarily segmented machines. So again, that's just one of the other requirements. And then last, but certainly not least, the continuous face support. That means you need positive face support at the cutter head to counteract any ambient pressures that are out there, you know, your groundwater pressure, your soil pressures, any of your overburden. So it's those four items right there that define the term microtunneling. And I'm particular when I say that because there's a lot of loose use of that word microtunneling, and you know, you got to check all those boxes to make sure that that you're, you know, working with the real deal. The slurry infused soil, basically just how the method works is, as you're cutting the ground, you mix your cuttings in a mixing chamber right on the front. You mix them with your slurry. They're forced into the front of the machine under a controlled environment, and then they're hydraulically pumped back to the surface using a closed loop slurry system. So that's how the whole thing works. That's why it gets its name. And because of that system and how that works, it's utilized in, as it says right there, in virtually any ground condition. I mean, it loves water. If you have water, that's fine. If you don't, that's fine. It likes a little bit of water, a lot of water. So, I mean, it's a very versatile machine. Again, usually in high water environments, mixed ground, you know, a lot of things that would give other lesser or different technologies a run for the money. Slurry microtunneling is right at home in these really tough environments. So just a few key advantages, kind of sum all this up here. It allows you to put these tunnels in your easements and rights of way. If you think about a typical road, or not that typical is not the correct word, but if you think about a road right of way, let's just say, for example, we have a 50-foot right of way or a 60-foot right of way in an urban environment, and you've got to put a 50-foot deep line pipeline down there in unstable soils. It's going to be very difficult to do that from any type of a trenched operation, very expensive. By doing it trenchless, you eliminate a lot of those risks. So that's how you're allowed to keep these pipelines within existing rights of way. You minimize the ground settlement, as it says, because you're not digging it all up and having to put it back, and you really minimize your risk of settlement. The accuracy with the guidance systems that are available today is extremely high. So that allows you to work within smaller windows and smaller footprints. The soil conditions as they're changing, these machines are not as susceptible as it would be with other methods. As mentioned before, you know, the machines like water, so you have a very minimal need for dewatering. Usually it's only done at the shaft locations. And then overall, you're reducing your project risk, and you're reducing your risk based on all those things I just said, plus because you don't have open excavations and you know, all this extra equipment running around. There's just that really reduces the risk to the owner, and you know, risk, as we know, risk is money. And so by reducing the risk, you get to be a little bit more efficient with your project. So let's talk a little bit about the equipment itself. Originally, but you know, back in the 70s, this was in Japan, and they're kind of the king of tight spaces in urban environments there. And the original idea was over there. And they were small diameters, working in really small confined spaces. And then from there, the technology migrated through Europe, in particular Germany. And Germany kind of took it and ran with it a little bit and made it. And we started doing a lot of stuff in Germany. Berlin, in particular, was a big catalyst for how the equipment developed. It moved across the pond over to here. In the mid-80s or late-80s, I should say. Mid-80s, I'm sorry. Moved over here. First job in the U.S. was done in South Florida in 1984. And then so it was kind of a little hit and miss. You can imagine at that time this was a bit like a snake oil salesman rolling up out there. Nobody'd seen anything like this, so it took quite a bit of time to get off the ground and get things rolling here. But, again, so in the old system, the old days there, and still even today as things are developing, the machines were historically center drive. You had a drive motor on a drive shaft driving a cutter head, and so as you do that, there's a couple of different variations of how the soil enters the front end, but they're all primarily the same. As mentioned before, the soil comes in, mixes with that slurry, and gets pumped out, and that's true no matter what drive the machine has with it. It's got that pressure balance cutting chamber up on the front that does the mixing. Inside that chamber or at that chamber, you're also able to crush your cobbles and your boulders. You've got jet nozzles that uh, that help clear that chamber, help you work in those cohesive soils. And the early machines didn't have jets, so that's, you know, it's one of the little developments we get to talk about. Like these machines that were built back in the 70s and the 80s, they didn't have slurry jets up there. So, you know, when they got to these tougher ground conditions, it, you know, you didn't know you needed them at the time. But you know, so that's just one of the developments that came along. And then with that comes more control of the machines, the variable frequency drive or VFD controls, which helped you control the various speeds of the pumps and things. You know, and you didn't have that in the old days. Yeah, everything was direct drive. So again, as the equipment advanced, so did the capabilities. All of them, these are articulated machines. So they all have had a steering joint in them. The older machines, smaller machines, had a little two-point steer. The new modern ones are a nice three-point system that allow very precise control in all directions. And then bidirectional cutter heads, that's pretty standard across the industry. So what are some of the advancements that the industry has seen? Not so much recently, but just, you know, it started way back when, but they were an anomaly, and now they're being a little bit more commonplace. But first and foremost is face access drive machine. So now you've taken that center drive shaft out of the machine, and you're utilizing a periphery drive, like a ring gear type setup. And what that allows you to do is now you can put a hole in the middle. You can put a little door out there. And what that door, you know, the main reason to have that door out in the front there is for tooling changes. So that's the main idea, although some guys get a little crazy with, if we have some sort of an obstruction, we'll use it for that. And, well, you know, it's not really necessary, but backloaded cutters with that door on the front. Industry-wise, that's from about a DN 1200 and up. Now, as you can imagine, a hole in a machine on a DN 1200 is pretty small. But, hey, you just need to find a small guy, right? As you get a little bigger, the machines from about 82-inch or, say, 2-meter ID and up, you can fit those with an airlock so you can open that door underneath pressure. So, that, you know, again, as you move up in size, you get a little more complicated complicated with the equipment. As I mentioned there, face access, back-loaded cutters, that facilitates changing the cutters from inside the tunnel. Electric power packs that are on board, I mean, that's an advancement over the old days where you had to run lines all on these long tunnels all the way from the surface, which basically gave you some limitations on how far you can go. Now with the power packs on board, you know, you can just go for forever and ever. And cutter heads have really advanced with mixed ground cutters that can handle all kinds of things that are thrown at it. So kind of sum up what we're talking there, the longer distances, again, as the equipment gets better, the cutters, all of this stuff gets better, you can go longer distances. We talked about reducing the project risk. By going these longer distances and eliminating shafts and things like that, then you're eliminating your risk. The value engineering aspect of it is huge. That's where some your curved tunnels and your longer tunnels are going to come into play. We'll talk about that in just a little bit. But the longer runs and curved drives, that gives the opportunity to eliminate shafts, to more efficiently utilize your easements, and that again turns into a value for the owner. So the owner's allowed able to do more on these projects, do more trenchless. As I mentioned, airlocks are available on machines 82 and above, and that is kind of a specific number just because of those are OSHA requirements here domestically in the U.S. You have to provide a minimum of 78-inch ID for an airlock, and again, that's through PVHO and OSHA requirements. So that's if you see an airlock on something like a really small machine, then chances are it's come from offshore or from somewhere else. And then last but not least on there is the advantages are you're minimizing the need for intervention from the surface. And that, basically we're talking about tooling changes. When we say planned maintenance, that's what we're referring to, or tooling changes and things like that. So on these long drives where you know you're going to need to have a tooling change, then you can do that through the machine itself. So that's another advancement, another key advancement, I should say, a key benefit to having a face access machine. And then I mentioned the obstacle thing. You know, a lot of guys are still set on, oh, hey, I can open that door and remove an obstacle. But, you know, that's, in my opinion, that's a little iffy. So, again, a few more of the advancements. That was the MTBM that we were speaking of. Now with the advancements into the control systems, the systems have primarily moved all to digital control. In the old days, it was an analog, like a low voltage analog system, and I mean that's fine. They work just great, but you're distance limited. I mean, as the further out you go, you're relying on the signals to open and close these valves and to get readings back from your transducers, and distance plays a huge role in that. So now, by moving to an all digital system, you've pretty much taken the distance limitation out of it, and so that's one of the key advancements, in my opinion, to what's allowing us to go these longer distances and do more work today. The higher horsepower motors, we're increasing the voltage on the motors to reduce the cable size. So again, you think, okay, let's just add more power to the machine. That's really cool, but more power means you need a bigger cable. Well, so then you have to counteract that by reducing the voltage on your motors. So again, that's all a product of now I can go farther and I can do more with more power, but I'm doing it with smaller cable sizes. Metals and metallurgy science has gotten quite a bit better. So now instead of just having, the old days where you just had a steel cutter head and you do this and you do that, and when you got to the other side, you repaired all the stuff that was worn out. Now you've got these really cool metals and cool hard facing and things that you can do that just make these machines that much more robust for going these longer distances under these more adverse conditions. And again, more available power options for slurry pumps, because we're pumping a slurry a long way. So if you've increased your capabilities from say 500 feet to 1500 feet, well, that's really cool. But now you're pumping your slurry three times as far, and things like that. So that requires more power. And then last but certainly not least on that list is automated lubrication systems. We're going to talk a little bit more about that later on, but that's a huge, huge thing, a huge development with these longer tunnels, because I think any of us that's been around this industry for any time, you know that when you, kind of the old days, you get out there a little distance, and that's one of your biggest fears is your jacking loads, and proper lubrication really minimizes that. So control systems themselves, I mean, they really come a long way. The photo that you're seeing there is our latest and greatest, our current system, all digital system in front of the operator. That's come a long way from the old system where you had these big, looked like a big old submarine dials and TV screens and, just normal TV signals. But everything is, I mentioned earlier, it's remote controlled. Everything is done from that console right there in front of that operator. What you see him looking at in that photo, he's looking at his target, his steering screen right in front of him, just to the right on the main panel. That's the machine control. That screen controls everything that happens with the machine, the valves opening, closing, all your pressures, all your pump speeds, all of that. The systems that you see, the two remote video screens you see there, there's cameras all around the entire job site. The operator is able to look inside the head. He's able to look up on his slurry plant. He's able to look down in the shaft and just basically monitor everything that's going on right there. So again, everything that's there on the site, and this is kind of true for all manufacturers. As all these jobs are requiring this level of control these days. So what are we doing to make that a little better? Well, what's going on now is it's just more robust control systems, more capable systems. I mentioned the old analog system. You had these big, giant cables, these big control cables, all these multi-pin, very sensitive cables that used to come back, and you were limited in the control by what you could put in that cable. So maybe your cable had 60 pins in it. Okay, well, you were able to only control maybe 25 or 30 functions with that cable. Where the new digital systems, there's virtually no limit to that. What you're looking at on those two photos, I hesitate to call the top picture the old system, but it is kind of an old system with how the cables are connected to these. That's a PLC input output or I/O module. That system is not weatherproof. You had to utilize that and put it inside a sealed box, usually nitrogen purged box in the head in the tunnel, in case you had any sort of water intrusion. Where we've now, with utilizing these more robust modules like you see down there at the bottom, they're not required to go in a box anymore. The IP rating is high enough that they're allowed to go in your tunnel now. So what that does is that allows you to put more control in smaller spaces. So now you can take that, you can have the same control in these little 30-inch heads now that you used to, you know, maybe you had a minimum size prior to that was, you know, a foot or so bigger. So again, controls, everything has gotten more powerful, more capable, and smaller, you know, just like as you would expect with cabling, or with technology, I should say. You know, another thing that kind of comes into this is a little bit this and that pass screen with remote and online display. So you see the operator looking at that, but it's also a very common request today that we get where the project owner or the project engineer, he wants to see how things are going too. So, you know, what we have now, you have the capability of doing that remote. You're also able to do that online. You know, you tie that computer system to the interweb, and basically you can utilize an internet portal to check in and check the alignments or maybe check your data log. So there's, again, technology is really, really advancing quite quickly in the guidance. So let's talk a little bit about navigation systems. I hesitate again to call it old days, but you know that's basically what it was. You know, this industry started out; it's laser guided. I mean, all the machines going even way back were laser guided, but they were very simple. It was a laser that was just shooting a simple target. You know, just a little single plane target, or basically, you know, jokingly just call it like a dinner plate. It's just a little white plate with some lines on it. And maybe you were shooting that with a CCTV camera. So all you did was, you know, you just looked at that image of where that target is, and so it took a lot of processing, mental processing for the operator. So that's why you see the little heading here. It's a passive guidance system. So essentially, you got a two-dimensional or one-dimensional, however you want to classify it, image, and you had to look at that and do all of the math and all of the deducing in your head and say, okay, well, this is what I'm doing. I think the machine is angled this way, so let me go in this direction. So the operator had a huge, huge part of how things progressed as far as steering the tunnel with the limited information that he had in front of him. The second two bullet points that are on there, again, requires quite a bit of manual interpretation. Limited availability as far as the attitude. I mean, you know, again, you had the inclinometers and things like that were very archaic. So, I mean, it's a very good and very capable system, but at the same time, limited. And then at the last one on there, the data logging. I mean, the data log was essentially, it consisted of, you know, you wrote down on a piece of paper what you did. So that's where things were up until, you know, not too terribly long ago. I mean, it's, you know, maybe 10, probably 20 years ago, we were still using these systems. And then along came these active guidance systems, which now all of a sudden, you know, now the introduction of computers, and you're getting dual plane targets, where a target now utilizes, as the name implies, dual planes, and it understands the attitude of the machines. It understands if it's tilted down, tilted right, tilted left, and now you're starting to get some three-dimensional capabilities in your tunnel. Or with your guidance system. So now you get to do some predicting, and you get to understand how the steering rolls. If, you know, again, the computer is starting to help you out with, if I continue, let's just say, for example, it gives you a 10-foot projection, and the computer helps you out to the point where, okay, if I keep my machine steered at this particular angle in 10 feet, I'm anticipated to be at this location. So, again, it starts with these dual-plane active guidance systems. Now you're starting to, you know, let the machine help you a little bit more. Again, the active target is actively reporting. It's taking the laser spot, and it's reporting that back to you with a digital signal, reporting that back to the HMI that's available to the operator. Now you have a very precise location of where the machine is. So as you move along with that, The what you see on the screen is the Akkerman system, you know, our proprietary system. It displays all of that information right on the screen. And I showed you in the earlier photo, you have a couple of different computer screens up there with all of this machine control at the operator's fingertips. Well, all of those points are recorded in the data log. I mean, there's well over 100 points that's recorded in there. All of your data logs are customizable depending on what you want to see. I mean, for example, a report that you want to give to an owner is going to have all of the tunnel specific stuff. It's going to have the line and the grade, you know, your deviations here, probably going to have some jacking pressure, maybe some slurry pressures. Whereas a data log that you want to give to your mechanic or somebody doing some troubleshooting, maybe it's going to have more machine-specific information. You know, what was the motor temperature on the drive motor in the head? What is the oil temperature? You know, so again, very highly customizable reports. So moving forward now, what are the advancements with these active guidance systems? Well, now the, you know, kind of the latest thing with us, and basically the latest thing in the industry, is our azimuth-based system. It's a survey-based system using an active robotic theodolite, and it's, to be quite honest with you, it's kind of the coolest thing out there. With you know, it's a self-surveying system, surveys itself all the way back to the shaft, back to known points. Again, a little bit more on that later. But what you're, that's the image, that screen image you see right there, is that now we're looking at a, you can see that tunnel. It's a predictive tunnel now, or I'm sorry, yeah, it's giving you that image of that tunnel that still utilizes the active, the normal target that comes with your machine. It can be a standalone system for an Akkerman slurry machine. It could be any manufacturer's machine. Again, it can be standalone or integrated. It could work with a TBM system. It could work with an EPB system. So that's one of the most unique features about this about this system. Self-leveling units that go throughout the tunnel. They're maintaining. Again, they're always surveying themselves back to a known point. We'll just kind of skip ahead here just a little bit so you can get a visual on what we're talking about. But this guidance system is capable of being used for straight or curved alignment. So now you can do these long straight shots that, you know, are outpacing what you could do with a laser, but you can also do your curved shots as well. So just a few advantages there. You're minimizing the downtime by tunnel surveying, and that is something that is specific to this AZ-100 system that we're talking about here now. I mean, the system is self-surveying. It's automatic. It does that. It always surveys itself back to the shaft, back to known points at the shaft. So the minimal surveying cost, that relates directly to that. All right, so what that means is the only survey that is required, is you have to survey the shaft. All right, you need to know where you're starting, and no different than any other microtunnel system. So once you give the computer or you give the guidance system its known coordinates, that's all that's required. Now, every job that we've been on, contractors, they do periodically come in and survey the tunnel, but that is 100% for peace of mind. And I mean, obviously, you know, owner requirements and things like that. But what I can tell you that in each case, they've come in and they survey, and it's a double check. That's exactly what it is. And again, we find a lot of contractors, when they're doing that, once their confidence level gets built, then they start kind of spacing out those external surveys because they have the confidence in the machine, because that's essentially what it's doing, is it's consistently or continually surveying itself back to its known coordinates. So what you're really doing is you're verifying that nothing has moved on your outside coordinates. I mentioned that it's a standalone system. Again, it works. It integrates perfectly into the Akkerman TGS guidance system, but it can also work on any other system, whether it be a microtunnel system or a pipe jacking, TBM, EVB, doesn't matter. It's automatic or real-time survey. Basically, you could set it up to do, either a time-based or distance-based survey automatically, or at any given time, the operator can just hit a button, and it does what we call a hit. You know, basically, you can, you know, right there, if let's say he's down for any particular reason, maybe, you know, changing a slurry line or add a pipe in, if for any reason he wants to know, hey, where am I at right now, he just hit this little button, boom, the whole thing. The time is very quick. It's a product of how many stations that you have in the tunnel, but essentially we're talking less than a minute. Usually it's 30 to 40 seconds. Extremely high level of accuracy, and we're finding that in practice this is repeatable. That the equipment itself is very capable, but things in the tunneling environment, things are or, you know, always, you know, you have all these factors working with you, but we're finding that after doing several of these that the system is extremely, extremely accurate. And then, of course, I mentioned that it certainly can work with other manufacturers' equipment. All right, just a little visual of what we're talking about here. I know it's going to be difficult for a lot of y'all to see those little words, but what you're looking at is the first step of this. As mentioned, the AZ100 system can do straight or curved tunnels. What you're seeing right here is either your straight tunnel. You're seeing the little yellow spot right there in the middle. That's the shaft station or your shaft theodolite. It's set up. It's surveying its system itself. It knows where it is spatially based on the prisms that have been previously surveyed by your external surveyor. And it's doing that. It's doing the math, and it's shooting a laser all the way up to the heading. Right at the back of the MTBM. So it's going to do that. That's your straight tunnel alternative right there. So that machine or that system, the way it is right now, it gets derives its power from the control container up top. I mentioned it surveys itself, so it's continually surveying the head. It's doing, give it a minute or two or whatever your interval is. It checks itself, on its two reference prisms. It says, okay, I'm pretty good. Boom, I turn the laser back on, shoots itself back to the head. It does that continually while you're mining, when you're down, when as long as you have it turned on, it's always surveying itself. So moving ahead with that, it's like, okay, what do I do now if I'm going to, now I'm getting longer tunnel or now I'm starting my curve. All right, so what I do now is I take that shaft station, that's a laser projecting theodolite, and I'm going to move that forward in the tunnel. I'm going to put that, I usually put it around 300 feet. That's not a hard number, but somewhere in that, 300, whatever, just in that range, put that behind the head just so you get a good crisp laser that shoots to the target. And that's the only, by the way, that's the only laser on the job. All the theodolites, they do their communication by infrared. So when they're looking at that, at prism, they're doing that by infrared, which is a much, much cleaner, much more robust signal. But our machine responds to laser, as do all microtunneling machines. So we're going to move that, as the image shows there, we're going to move that up. And then now you have your shaft station that's back there that used to project a laser forward. Well, he's doing his same job. He's still referencing himself to the prisms that are located in the shaft. But what he's doing now is he's communicating with that pipe station theodolite up there that's always telling him. So that pipe station, he's shooting his laser on the head, and he goes, hey, hang on a minute, let me turn around, let me talk to my buddy back in the shaft. He's going to reference himself, and he goes, okay, I'm good. He spins back around, shoots a laser back on the head. Again, it's a continual system that everybody is checking themselves, as they go along. I mentioned that it's programmable. You can do it automatically, time distance based, or you can do it manually. It's whatever is up to the operator. You're always getting a real-time distance measurement. There's an EDM, there's a prism right on the back of the MTBM. So you've got a live, real-time image of exactly where your machine heading is at all times. The target, you still have a full functionality of your target system that gives you all of your roll and your inclination of the machine. So you have all of that information right back to you, just as you would in any other environment. And again, full data recording capabilities that go right along with this system. So here's just a little overview, like a plan view. Obviously, it's a very extreme curve, but you can kind of see what happens now if you're looking at this from above. So essentially what you're doing here, I mean, it's quite simple. It's a line of sight system. So if you're going around a curve, those stations need to see each other. And again, they see each other via infrared. So what you're seeing right there is just that. From left to right, you've got the shaft station back there. It's looking at its low reference points. The prisms there, though, again, that's what's required to be surveyed. You need to know where those points are. There's two of them shown, but that's one of those situations where the more the merrier. The more of those that you put in there, the more accurate your system is. Now, it's no different than a GPS system working, on your car or if you're out walking around. If a GPS signal, if you have your phone, for example, a GPS signal, if you can reference two satellites, then you're pretty accurate. If you can reference three or four or five satellites, then you're extremely accurate. It's no different with this. So again, two is required. But any, you know, we're starting to see on these more intricate projects where guys are putting in more prisms, and then you get some redundancy in there. That way, you have some backup in case one of your prisms gets knocked offline for whatever reason. Basically, what you're looking at right there, each one of those little robotic theodolites, they're looking at each other. Those dotted lines that you can probably barely see, they're looking both ways, and they do that in projecting the laser on the head. And again, all of this is recorded. Everything comes right back to the operator. This is what it looks like in the tunnel. All right, so that's an actual photo of a robotic theodolite. It's there, basically a total station. It's got his EDM, that little blue guy up on the top. You know, that's the infrared deal. It's looking at the is looking for the prisms on the other end. So it spins around and it's looking at his buddy up front, and then it references himself to his buddy in the back. And so that's what it does continuously, is it's looking at those two. That kind of goofy looking, I call it a hockey stick, that little deal that's down there. I mean, that's the blocker plate. Basically, what that is for is in case, what you don't want to do is have your theodolite look at the wrong prism. And those happen, or potentially could happen, usually when you're starting a curve. And so, you know, when you're starting a curve, you go, hey, I'm going to go ahead and put my station in right now because I know I'm getting ready to start in the curve. There's always the chance that there could be more than two theodolites visible at any given time. So you just put those little blockers in there just to make sure you don't have any errant signals, and there's a very, very slim chance that that it can see the wrong guy, but you know, never know. It could always check and see the wrong prism. All right, so getting away from navigation a little bit, let's move over into lubrication. Again, the old days, you know, we've always lubricated tunnels. Been doing that since the dark ages, and you know, we creatively showed you a little ball valve right there. But essentially, that's what it was. I mean, you know, you would lubricate periodically throughout your tunnel, you know, different ports in there. But there was a ball valve on each one. And you know what? You'd find your smallest guy or whoever lost the bet, and he was the guy that got to go in there. And it was a very highly technical system where you would say, hey, man, I need you to go in there and open that valve a little bit. All right? So that works really good when you're going 200 feet or 500 feet, but you know, when you're trying to go 1,000, 1,500 feet, that's, you know, the variances in that they varies wildly, as you can imagine. So that was the shortcomings with that. I mean, number one, it requires personnel entry in there, you know, because and there, all the hazards that go along with that. But again, it was very difficult to gauge exactly how much you had going in there. If you had each valve open just a little bit here or there, it just made it very, very difficult. So what's the advancements with that? All right, where we're headed is let's automate that. All right, so that's what we've done, is we've taken the little ball valve out of the equation. We're still lubricating the tunnel at that point, but now we're automating it. All right, we have an electronic controlled valve that's right there, and that valve it opens and closes at specific times. And so that's what you do. So you open that valve, you know exactly what's coming out of that particular port at any given time. And so the fact that you can open that, and then another big factor here is the sequencing. So where you would pump lubricant at your head, then you come back and you pump lubricant at pipe one, then you go back to your head for 30 seconds and you come back to pipe two. And then you go to, you know, anyway, you got this little sequencing thing, and because you know what you're doing, you know exactly where you're putting lubricant at any given time, that you know that you've got, you know, because you only have one valve open at a time, you know positively that you're getting some lube coming out of that port at any given time there. So that's a whole lot better system than opening four different valves a little bit. You know, so now you know exactly what you've got going there. All of this can be controlled. What you're seeing in that photo right there is a touchscreen monitor that is controlled by the operator. And again, it's all programmable to your tunnel. You know, a couple of the advantages of what we're talking about there. Again, a lot of it doesn't need repeating. You know, it's putting an automated lube right at that exact point in exact intervals. You know what you're doing. It's all controlled. Everything's done from above. You don't have to, you know, send your guys in the tunnel. Because it's automated and it's pinpoint specific, you know exactly what you're putting there at any given time. It goes without saying, when you reduce your jacking forces, you can go longer distances, so that's pretty simple. Integrated IGS capability, this was very important for us because the automatic bentonite system, IGS control, and lighting system, those go hand in hand on longer tunnels. So, you know, it was a no-brainer for us to put all of that capabilities right into a single unit. And then, again, another system that's standalone. I mean, yes, it integrates very well into our systems, but it'll work with any manufacturer's equipment or any type of equipment. So here's just a little visual overview of what we're talking about. You see in the upper part of that image, you've got the control panel up top, you got your bentonite up top, and then spaced throughout the tunnel, you have these control valves. So again, you put as many or as few of those in there as required based on your anticipated lubrication needs there. So each remote station controls multiple automatic valves. So I mean, again, you don't have to have a station for every valve. All of it's data logged. Again, every pressure, every valve, everything can be logged and reported. We mentioned it's got an integrated control of the pump, which is, again, that eliminates another guy. You know, you find, because the operator can control both the valves and the pump itself. And then I mentioned that the IGS and the tunnel lights are all controlled there. Just a few little screenshots. I know it's kind of difficult to see the small words, but what you're looking at right here, the top right there, that's the actual bentonite, the control valve itself, or the control screen. And what all of those little squares and little dots are right there is that's each individual valve's performance. All right, so, I mean, you're looking at this valve is open for this long and it's got this many gallons and here's the pressure. The bottom left screen, same thing with the interjack. Each interjack is controlled individually. You know your pressure and you know your distance. And the bottom right is the tunnels. The tunnel lights. So, you would think that you want all your lights on at one time, but I mean, who knows? Maybe you want the lights on in one spot and you'll have them off in another spot so a guy can get some sleep. Who knows? So again, moving a little forward here, some other advancements. Basically, what we got going here, disc cutters, like on the machines, cutter technology is really improved, and it's really, really pretty cool what guys are doing now. You got higher capacity bearings and a smaller package, gives you more robust cutters. The developments and separation systems designed just for us. Now, we're not using old oil field equipment anymore. Better additives for your slurry. Now you've got some really cool viscosifiers and torque reducers, surfactants, flocculants, things like that. And then last but not least, that last little paragraph to me is huge. The knowledge that's out here in the world right now, it results in better designs and it results in better performance by contractors. So that's to me, that's a huge thing. So let's just spend real quick, go through some couple of case studies. Again, this is where we're putting the money to our mouth. Our mouth where money is. Very first one that we're going to talk about, this was we did a little airport runway crossing up in Canada. Again, you can see a lot of the particulars on the screen there. This was the project shale bedrock. No access from the surface, which you would expect on an airport runway. All of your tooling changes, any of that had to be done, through the machine, hence the front door on the machine. The owner required that we have an airlock on this one, just in case they had to do that under pressure. As far as the project itself, this job was done back in 2015, and it took just a little over 5 weeks to complete the tunnel. That wasn't all uptime. There was a little bit of downtime in there for various things, but again, very, very efficient. Use of the equipment in the tunnel, and then a few little particulars of the project itself. Some of the challenges there. Again, anytime you're working at an airport, you can imagine all of the clearances and challenges that you had to work through. Moving on, Paradise Whitney. This was a project in Las Vegas. Overall, it was a 13 mile, like a multi-year project. About 25,000 feet of that, about 5 miles or so. Was trenchless. Worked in upwards of some 10,000 psi caliche, and again, just a pretty cool job. But there were some really long drives on this one here, that's why they utilized our AZ100 system. We also utilized an auto lube can behind the MTBM to promote good lubrication as around the tunnel, which again helped you on those good long runs. Then moving forward, we got a raw water intake project that we did up in Canada, small diameter tunnel, or relatively small diameter, but it was we tunneled out into the river and did a wet recovery out in the river, wet retrieval. So that that adds a whole other element of difficulty to it, utilizing pipe breaks and all of that. But what they were doing, they were separating their water intake system from their hydroelectric water system. The soils were basically clays and sands, pretty wet, unstable soils, about 14 meters deep. Had a the launch shaft was a 9 meter deep caisson. Again, I mentioned it was a wet recovery. Kind of a couple of little caveats to that. They, when the machine was coming out in the bottom of the river, they had divers down there, removing this like a big giant tree stump and some boulders and a whole bunch of other crap out of the way so that they could retrieve the machine. So that part was kind of cool with what they were doing there. Did this job in just a little over 2 weeks. The actual drive there. So that was pretty good. Let's see, what else we got here? Omaha, done a couple of projects in Omaha, and this was a pretty nice little job here. It was a bedrock job, or started out as a bedrock job with a TBM, and contractor was working down there, life was good, rocking along, and all of a sudden they got out of the bedrock, and they hit a bunch of anticipated soil conditions, and that machine stopped. I mean, the ground became very unstable, so they re-engineered the job, put a rescue shaft down, recovered that machine, brought a slurry machine in, and did the final project with the remaining 800 to 900 feet of that with a slurry machine drilled back to their little rescue shaft. But again, that was a good, nice little job. Pretty tough job conditions and pretty hard rock, around 12,000 psi rock. But again, very, very successful job. Comes out right on target. Moving on here, Airport Road, again, another project up in Canada. This was a nice little curved drive, a little over 1,100 meter radius, small diameter, 48 inch diameter. So that was, you can see we're starting to get a little better, getting into smaller, smaller diameters, longer distances, that sort of stuff. Sands, gravels, some clays, some silts on this project here, but again, very, very, very successful project. And you just see there a couple of the challenges, traffic, small clearances, real tight windows that they were having to work in. And then another one here, just coming in to the end here, is another one in Cleveland. This was a curved drive, another small diameter, 48. This one was kind of cool that it was a value engineer getting away from straight tunnels to a curved, and they did the curved tunnel to move the alignment away from this historic building. Before, they were dreadfully close to it. They moved it, I think, 34 or 37 feet away to gain a little bit more distance so they didn't damage this old historic building, a Western Reserve building. It was a unique tunnel that was about 60 foot of straight tunnel. Then it was a 336-foot curve, and then you went back to another 368 feet of straight. So it was kind of a straight curve, straight deal. Glacial Till did this job in about 14 days of mining to finish that little job up right there. And again, you can see the guys are all happy and all smiley. Came out right where they decided they wanted it. And with that, I'm going to take a breath. I'm going to take a drink of water, and I'm going to let you guys talk to me for a minute. What do you think about that? Sharon, you want to drive this thing for a minute?
Sure. We just have actually, it was a great presentation. We have time for just a few questions because we're coming up against the top of the hour. So as you're taking your sip of water there, one of the questions we have is, what was the optimum depth between direct bury and trenchless?
Wow, that's a good question. A lot of that has to do with, there's a couple of ways to look at that. As far as the mechanics of things, of how the equipment works, I grew up in this industry with the three diameters of cover rule of thumb. That's how, 25 years ago, that was what I was originally told. I've seen, as we've advanced in technology, I've seen that cut down to nowadays, two diameters cover is pretty common. In extreme circumstances, you could see it less. So that's That's from a mechanical standpoint. When you're looking at it from an economic standpoint, you got to weigh your open cut costs versus, you know, your trenchless costs. But I don't think that was the intent of the question. So I think from, you know, actual cover, put a point on it. I would say probably in these days, depending on your soil conditions, as long as you had a good homogeneous soil condition and things weren't too unstable, I would be satisfied with two diameters of cover.
Another question is, what are some typical production rates in feet per day for this system?
Wow, we could sit here and talk about, and we could answer that question till tomorrow. There's so many variables, and I know I sound like I'm dancing around the question, but that has so many variables on you know, what's the length of your pipe, what's the soil condition, are you welding your pipe, are you pushing a jointed pipe, you know, like a RCP. But I guess if I just had to throw a dart at the board and say, from a typical standpoint, I would say somewhere, again, there's no limitation or no assumptions here on any bad ground conditions or any of this and that. I would say if you could accomplish somewhere in the 40 to 60 feet per shift, you're doing okay. Now, with every one of those jobs, you're going to have a job that you can only do 20 foot. And with every one of those, you're going to have another job. These guys are over here knocking out 100 foot. But, again, if you could knock out 40, 50-ish right in there on a average day, I think you've got a pretty good shift.
Another question is asking, periphery drives are not generally used on larger slurry shield TBMs and because of the deformation of shield can compromise to the bearings. Is this a problem with MTBMs?
Well, no, actually, it's the opposite for MTBMs. Is the center drive machines, you get to a size, a diameter, basically, where it becomes impractical to have a center drive machine. I mean, the motor and the gearbox and the drive shaft would just have to be so big. So I would say, no, that we don't have those same limitations. And that's not necessarily just because of the industry, but the way that the machines are constructed, that as an industry, we're starting to look real hard somewhere right in that 60 to 72 inch range. Everything above that, there's a strong likelihood that it's going to be periphery drive and center drive below that. That's just, you know, rough. That's a rough line, but that's where I see the industry going.
You also had a couple questions asking about the curve radii and what can be achieved
From a machine standpoint, from a guidance system standpoint, there are no limitations. I shouldn't say none. I mean, you got to have something. But that is, first and foremost, that is a product of your pipe choice and your pipe engineering. So the tighter your curve, the shorter your pipe sections, the more robust your pipe joints have to be. You could potentially start getting into maybe a pipe, you know, that has a joint specifically for curves and things like that. But as far as the system itself, the principles of the system, there are no limits on that. It's just, you would just put more pipe stations in. So, that's 100% a product, in my opinion, of your pipe choice.
We have time for just one more question, and this one's asking if MTBM dirt wings are a specialty of Akkerman.
I think everything we do is special, so we'll go with that. But I can't say that they're an exclusive specialty because, as we learned at the very beginning of today, I used to work for Soltau, and we had them on our Soltau machines. And so, I mean, what they are, think of them more as a stabilizer. You know, they're not a corrector. They're a stabilizer or a preventer. Misuse some words here. So by putting them out there on some of our larger machines, when we have the space, like when I say larger, I mean once we start getting into that 60, 72 and above, we'll put multiple hydraulically operated dirt wings or stabilizers on there. Primarily, your roll control is handled by the bidirectional cutter head, but having a couple of dirt wings engaging the soil out there just gives you that much more stability.
Okay, we had several more questions, but We're not going to be able to address those in the live Q&A, and they will be addressed offline via email. This concludes the session of the Trenchless Technology webinar series. Thank you to all of our attendees for joining us today, and I'd like to also thank our speaker, Troy Stokes, for his participation, and Akkerman for sponsoring this session. As a reminder, today's webinar will be archived at trenchlesstechnology.com if there's something you missed or would like to refer back to. Thank you again, and we look forward to seeing you online at a future webinar.